Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
79 games are in the bag, and we're looking at the final three games of the season as Matt and I are here to talk about the last week and look ahead to the final week of the season. Matt, how you doing?
Good.
Before we get started this week, I think we should probably say a get well to Peter Labardius. He's been out as the Flames radio commentator for a few weeks now. Do you remember what day was his last day?
Not at all. I think it was about a week and a half ago, though.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think it was about the... I want to say the Colorado game, Toronto game, somewhere in there.
Yeah, something like that.
It's weird how we judge time based on our opponents.
True.
So no news about Labardius has come out, but he's obviously pretty sick for him to be missing that many games. I mean, Peter's a guy who's always working, always on top of things. So we talked a little bit about how Derek Wills was doing last week by himself. We heard him call games with Steinberg again this week. But I hope that Labardius does well, and I'm hoping that we might get to hear his voice again in the next week.
Yeah, and I just hope that whatever is ailing him is he's able to deal with promptly, so we can continue to hear from him for the next season.
Well, I guess the good thing is he's going to have a long summer to recover.
Yeah, well, if you're going to have an issue when getting it right before you're done for the year so you can spend 4 or 5 months off recuperating, that's a good thing.
Yeah, and I mean, it's not like we're going to a playoff here where, you know, he's going to have a problem or where he's going to need to, you know, be expected to be doing a lot of play-by-play. So I think the fact that, yeah, we're almost done. It's, you know, going to be a regular season exit. He's not leaving us in a jam of having one man during the playoffs. I think that, you know, we can deal with Labardius not being around for the next three games, and then hopefully he'll recover as he needs to over the summer. Well, Matt, why don't we move away from the sad topic of Labardius and talk about, I guess, what might be an equally sad topic, which is the final last week of games. Flames played three games last week. The first game we were a bit worried about. We hoped they'd break the curse in the Honda Center, and I don't think we broke it. I think that, if anything, the curse got the better of us in an 8-3 loss against the Ducks. This was a tough loss that saw both Hiller and Backstrom take the net for the Flames. Interesting that Ordeo wasn't even dressed. Do you have anything to say about this game?
It's another game in Anaheim, and yeah... That's about all you can say. Whether the Flames get a lead or they give up three goals early, you just know that that L is coming at the end of the night, one way or the other. They tied the record with 23 straight. So, not exactly a record that you would want to have, but it's a record nonetheless.
My mom always taught me, if you have nothing nice to say, don't say anything at all. I've been racking my head all week trying to find something nice to say in this game, and I can't find anything.
Yeah. Let's just skip on to the next one.
Yeah, I think you're right. It's another game in Anaheim, and luckily a game that doesn't mean anything in Anaheim.
Precisely.
The next one, we didn't fare too much better. We went down the road from Anaheim to L.A., where the Flames took on the Kings in L.A., and this is a 3-0 loss to the L.A. Kings. I must say, a much better Kings team than last year. You might remember a similar game on the schedule last year where the Flames, I think it was the Flames, put the Kings out of commission and out of the playoffs. And we're seeing a much more focused Kings team this year, a team that I think might go deep into the playoffs.
Yeah, they're the team that I'm actually picking to win the Stanley Cup this year.
And even with I could definitely see them winning the Stanley Cup. I think they've got a better makeup, and I think even some of the additions like Lucic, who are playing better. This
even just depth guys like LeCavalier, Shen, and Scuderi.
Isn't it weird talking about LeCavalier as a depth guy?
True, but even just having those secondary players, I think that was one of the main things that they were lacking last season. So having those guys in the fold should allow them to steamroll anybody in the playoffs.
You're probably right. Flames came into this one after a tough loss the night before. Yoni Ordeo played the entire game in this one. I thought Ordeo didn't look too bad, if you ask me. But again, you know, the Flames couldn't do anything here. And I think this was another game where you can definitely see the Flames are outmatched as a bottom team taking on one of the top teams. All night, it looked like a David and Goliath matchup.
Yeah, and any time the Flames did actually get any chances in on the Kings, Jonathan Quick was there to make the saves and collected a shutout. Not much you can do. When you're running into a good goalie who's on his game, that's going to be tough regardless of who you are. And all it took was a couple of goals going their way and 3-0 victory for Los Angeles.
Yeah, you're right that Quick was hot, but I think outside of even Quick, like you said, this is a deep team, and I just think that with the lines that were out there, the Flames third, fourth lines, you know, were outmatched and outplayed by a very deep LA third and fourth line. And I think it was just tough all night for us to line match with LA.
Oh, for sure.
But
yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing the Ducks play the Kings in round two.
Yeah, if that's the way it shapes out, that would be a fun matchup to watch.
Yeah, I don't see either Nashville or San Jose putting up much of a resistance to either of those teams.
Yeah, I don't know.
I like both San Jose and Nashville, but you just look at who they're playing, and yeah, I don't even see those series going to six.
Yeah, we can talk more about our predictions next week. I think you could be right. I don't know. San Jose has a tendency to choke in the playoffs. I hope.
Yeah, same with Nashville.
True. So, yeah, it should be a fun series. There's not many playoff series I tend to watch if the Flames aren't in it, but if we get LA and Anaheim, I think I'd probably end up watching that one. So anything else you want to talk about the second loss of the week?
Not particularly.
Then let's take a trip back home, or I guess close to home, to Edmonton. The Flames came back for their third road game. They were playing in Edmonton. This is the final Battle of Alberta ever to be played in the Northlands Coliseum, the Skyreach Center, whatever you want to call it. That arena's had so many names over the years. And really an iconic game because of that. I mean, you know, the Oilers are getting their new arena. Probably some jealousy there from Flames brass around that. It's going to be interesting to see the new arena in Edmonton, but we sent them out of their current arena on a high note for us anyways, not for the Oilers. But this was finally a blowout for the Flames after getting blown out twice. In Rexall Place, we beat the Edmonton Oilers 5-0. Thoughts on this one?
I thought it was interesting that the Oilers were all over the Flames in the first 11 minutes. I do believe the shots at that time were like 9-2, and they just couldn't get one past Ordeo. And after that point, they just stopped playing entirely, and then the Flames just walked all over them the rest of the game. They have the resiliency of a papier-mâché anything.
Papier-mâché Rexall Place.
True enough. That works.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, the first about 10 to 15 minutes I was watching thinking, wow, if the Oilers play like this, we're going to get our third blowout of the week. And after 15 minutes, I wouldn't say that necessarily the Flames started playing that much better in my eyes. I think the Oilers just deteriorated and started falling apart when the Flames started putting on a little bit of pressure.
Yeah.
Would you agree with that?
Pretty much. The Oilers are, like, I still can't understand, like, we were talking about how pathetic it was on, like, our first show, and this is episode 116, and they have not gotten any better, and, like, how? You know, it's 3.5 years later, and nothing's changed.
I say this every season, but I think it's going to change this summer. I think
I think
Chiarelli's the guy to do it. You don't bring in a guy like Peter Chiarelli not to make moves. And I think come, you know, our opening day show, we're not going to recognize the Edmonton Oilers roster.
No. Honestly, I think I would take the over if you're saying how many players being like five getting traded. I would actually take the over on that. I think that they're going to basically nuke the entire team, keep Draisaitl, Nurse, and McDavid, everybody else. If you get a proper offer, on your way out.
Well, I think there's a lot of just spare pieces on this team, too. Guys like Pat Maroon, Korpikovsky, you know, Letestu, like just these extra pieces that are pretty interchangeable. And I think that's one of the things that they need to change is just not having so many interchangeable pieces. Get some guys with some personality.
Yeah, it's basically a team of stagings. Like, the player's not going to really hurt you, but not really going to do much for you either.
Well, it looks like to me the Flames in our 04 run where we're just a team of everyone else's leftovers. Guys everyone else had traded to us because they didn't want them, or we picked up off waivers or free agency because no one wanted them. I mean, you know, looking down this roster, I don't see a strong roster here. I just see a bunch of pieces. And
yeah,
some,
like honestly, at this rate, like I don't even see this team making the playoffs by 2020. Like it's going to take a long time to.
Yeah, I
want to
reserve judgment and see what Chiarelli does before I say that.
Yeah. Well, he would have to make a handful of really good trades this offseason to make it that not being a thing.
I think in 2-3 years, he could have this team in playoff contention. Maybe not in the playoffs, but, you know, as a team that's actually contending for a wild card spot, if he is able to move everyone he'd want to move. And I think the biggest thing for him is going to be the salary cap and how that changes. He has a lot of fairly reasonably priced contracts, which might be affordable for a lot of GMs who are going to be looking to shed salary.
Quite possible.
I think you're going to see the Oilers take on some bad deals this year, though, in order to move some of their pieces.
Oh, for sure. Like, I could see a player like Taylor Hall being traded to some team for some quality prospects, maybe a decent player and a couple of crap contracts just to make things viable.
Yeah, I think the Oilers might be a team you see some trades done with if the expansion draft is officially announced this summer as well for next year in order to sort of get contracts off the books so they don't get claimed.
That works as well, yeah.
But yeah, it was a good game for the Flames. I was glad to see we didn't win our first ever battle in the Northlands Coliseum, or Rexall Place they call it now, but we made sure we won the last. And I thought this was a good game. I like these games that we're seeing now where we're seeing, you know, guys other than Goudreau and Monahan scoring. As much as Goudreau got two, Backlund got two, and Colborne got one. And what do you think about Colborne's offensive streak lately?
Oh, he's been coming into his own, and that's the thing with larger players like Colborne. It usually takes them 3 to 4 years in the NHL to figure themselves out, and Colborne's always been showing flashes of something there, just there was no consistency, and the last month and a half he's been pretty dynamite the whole way through, so it'll be interesting to see next season if this was just a flash in the pan and he returns to his former self, that inconsistent third line guy, or if the 30 plus point 20 goal Joel Colborne is the player that he actually emerges into.
Well, that's what I was going to say is, do you think that this guy is just simply figuring out now that, hey, I have a contract coming up. I should probably start, you know, playing like it's a contract year. Or do you think that this is the Joel Colborne we're going to see going forward?
If I was to guess, I would probably lean on this as actually who he is. Just because of the fact that we've been seeing flashes, especially over the last 18 months, that he looks like at times that he's figuring out how to be a quality second, third line player. And then, like, he'll disappear for 10 games, and then it'll look like he's having another competent streak, and then inconsistent again. But the fact that this recent streak has been for, like, a month and a half, 2 months now, you get to the point where perhaps this isn't just a hot streak. Maybe he's actually figuring out how to be a quality professional hockey league player in the NHL.
I think he's at least getting to the point, for me anyways, where I would give him another contract in hopes that he is starting to figure it out. I think if he didn't have this late season streak that we're seeing from him, I don't know that I would be as anxious to re-sign him come the offseason. I think that streaky Joel Colborne could be replaced.
Yeah, if you're talking the player that we saw for most of last year and
most
the early
of
part of this year, then if there you found a legitimate upgrade, then sure. But, you know, you keep the guy if not, because he's still a solid third-line player, even in the inconsistent mode. But if he's showing that he's more, then maybe you can rely on him being that quality secondary scorer that the team has lacked for most of the season.
Colborne's making $1.275 million in an RFA, so the Flames would have probably qualified him either way. I can't see them letting him walk.
No.
But yeah, I'm hoping that what we see earns him another contract here. I like Colborne, but you know, I think that he needs to come into his own. He really needs to figure out who he is as a player and play that game.
Yeah, I think if the Flames signed him to something like a 3-year, $2.5 million per, I think that would be fair for his production.
And so, how long would you see for term?
3.
Okay.
Enough where, like, it's not, like, he'll be a decent holdover if he returns to being inconsistent. And you could move him still.
Yeah, I still think there's value as an asset.
Yeah. Because he's basically providing the role that Mason Raymond was brought in to provide.
That's an interesting way of looking at it. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. And I think with Mason Raymond probably being banished now for good, we'll probably see Colborne, yeah, maybe stepping up into that role a little bit more. Interesting. Yeah, I never really thought of him and Mason Raymond being the same guy, like the same type of player. But yeah, you could be right. I look at Colborne as being a little bit more aggressive.
Yeah, they're not. It's not a great fit, but just in terms of like where they slot in the lineup and just the generalities, it's not like Raymond's more of a speedy scoring off the rush type guy, where Colborne's more stand in front of the net and whack it in.
Yeah, and I think Colborne, because of that, is more of what we would call a Calgary Flames player.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, that was a good win over Edmonton. I was really hoping for one of the players, either Goudreau or Backlund, to get the hat trick. That would have kind of been the icing on the cake for the Flames.
Yeah, actually, here's an odd coincidental thing. The day that the Flames and Oilers last met up in the playoffs was the day to the exact date that Yanni Ordio was actually born, and he got the shutout victory, his first game against Edmonton, in the last game in that building.
That is weird. Wow. How long did it take you to figure that out?
I read it online somewhere.
Okay. I was going to say, wow, you've had a lot of time on your hands this week.
Oh, yeah. I'd be like, you know, you got to get a life.
That's what I was wondering, Matt. I know you're a busy man. I thought, when did you come up with this? So, I mean, you know, we've got 79 games under our belt now. We had an okay week. We won, you know, one of the three games, three more games down the stretch, all of them looking hard for the Flames. At this point, do you find it hard to still be paying attention to this team?
No, not really. If you're looking only at, oh, well, we're going to miss the playoffs, then you would have turned this off in January, realistically, because this team's been out of it for months. But if you're looking for what's to come in the future, how the young players are progressing, that'll keep your attention. And, like, the Flames are, like, a tale of two teams. One, the one half of the team is pretty much at contender-level talent, and then the other team is, like, a really bad AHL team. And you combine the two, and, you know, the Flames are one of the worst teams in the league. And that's why you're seeing most of the better players having career seasons, both in goals, assists, points. And then the other half is just absolutely abysmal to the point of it just dragging the rest of the organization down.
So the thing keeping you watching is really the individual storylines.
Yeah, the good players on the team. And how, like, Will Backlund set career highs and goals? Will Colborne, Will Monahan match his season from last year? Will Hamilton?
One of the things that's interesting to me is to see if Bennett can get to 20 points, because that would be three straight seasons for a Flames rookie doing that. Or 20 goals.
Oh, I think he'd have to have a hat trick at some point.
Yeah.
Pretty soon.
Yeah, well, I mean, Bennett's coming up on that. He's been kind of, you know, on the verge of breaking out for a while.
Yeah.
20 goals. Not 20 yeah. points. Yeah. I'm the same. You know, I'm watching to see how the call-ups are doing. We'll talk later about Hunter Shinkaruk. We're seeing Emile Poirier. That, to me, is interesting.
Seeing Freddie Hamilton, Kenny Augustino, Watherspoon.
I'm really enjoying watching guys like Nikushkin emerge as an NHL player. There's a guy I thought would be here for a couple games. I did not expect him to stick around for the rest of the year. So it's interesting watching him emerge as a better NHL player. It's fun watching Joki Paka really become part of this team. So, yeah, to me, the biggest thing right now that's interesting is those individual storylines.
Yeah, well, if you're just looking at, oh, Flames aren't in playoffs, then you would have tuned out a long time
ago. Or even,
oh,
Flames aren't playing good hockey. I mean, this past week was a terrible week.
Yeah, true enough.
You know, you can still be with the team. And I know a lot of people have stayed past the playoffs, and then after the last couple road games, they've just kind of tuned it out, saying these guys are playing terrible. And yes, they are, but I also kind of want to see, can the veterans keep this thing together? Can the veterans rally together and, you know, end off the season on a high note? So, I don't know. To me, I'm looking down the stretch going, it's going to be a tough week, and I'm worried we might get blown out in a few of these, but I want to kind of, I don't know, we're this far into the story. I feel like I can't give up on it now.
No, and at least there's only three more games. Like, it's not like we are at game 60 where we have to watch another 20 games of, oh, they're terrible. You know, it's only three more.
It's like reading a book and not reading the last half of the last chapter.
Exactly.
You might
and then we can look forward all summer to how Bradshaw Living's going to address the issues in the team and all that kind of fun stuff. So
it's going to be a very interesting summer.
Yeah. That's the thing I'm most looking forward to.
So, yeah, I guess, you know, I wanted to address that because people have been talking about that on Twitter of what's really making you still watch this team, what's keeping you interested. And I think we've said it for the last couple of years, but the most interesting thing in the Flames organization right now is the young players, guys that are unexpected, guys that are, you know, doing different things. I think, you know, if you're watching this team hoping for good hockey, you're not going to get that for the rest of the year.
No.
Especially with our goaltending the way it is. But, you know, I think it's about watching who is and who isn't doing well. You know, what call-ups are looking good and which ones potentially aren't. And I think it's going to be a fun three games if you look at it that way. And speaking of young guys, we had a report last week on Mark Jankowski, and we talked about if he would sign a deal. I had said I hope he doesn't sign a deal to burn a year this year. Well, it sounds like they're going a bit of an alternate route. He signed with the Flames. He signed an entry-level deal for 2 years starting next season. And he's currently playing in Stockton on an amateur tryout agreement. So this means that he's not officially signed. He's just there as a tryout. Jankowski's wearing number 17 for the Stockton Heat and had a pretty good first week down there. He collected his first professional point as he assisted on a game winner by Watherspoon in the first game against the Rain. Matt, do you know who they have as his line mates right now?
They had him with Drew Shore and Austin Carroll. So they're easing him in on the third and fourth line.
I think it'd be really interesting to see Jankowski and Agostino playing together.
Yeah. Well, in that first game, he could have skated away with like a four-point night. One goal was actually waved off that it shouldn't have been. The puck did go over the line, but the ref reviewed it and said that it didn't, which was wrong, but that, you know, happens every once in a while. And two other plays where it was a good passing play by Jankowski to his line mate, and they just flubbed it, which happens, but...
So Jankowski,
if he was playing with better line mates, he probably would have had a 3 or 4 point night.
So right now he's played 2 pro games, 1 assist and 1 point. He's 0 plus minus and 0 penalty minutes as of right now. So not doing too bad. You know, sometimes it takes these guys a little bit of time to get up to speed. Probably a good idea to put him on the third line, let him get up to speed at the AHL level.
Yeah. Well, in that first game, he was probably the best offensive player for Stockton or Ontario. So it won't take him long to figure things out. Considering he's coming off the flu and all that, he looked pretty good.
And hopefully he'll stay healthy in the offseason. We've had some issues with Jankowski in the past with some injuries that he suffered. So hopefully he doesn't suffer any injuries this offseason, and he'll be ready to go come rookie camp in July.
Yeah. One thing I found interesting with him signing the contract that starts next year is that if the NHL has an expansion draft in 2017 and 2018, Jankowski will not be eligible with either. But if he had started it this year, he would have been eligible in the 2018 expansion draft.
Well, that's probably exactly why they did it. I think that this whole expansion draft, and I mean, we're still talking prematurely. We don't know that's going to happen, but I don't know about you, Matt. I'm about 90% sure this is going to happen.
Yeah, I'm more in the 99 to 99.9.
You don't start having these discussions in a league if you're not going to expand. You don't hypothetically put out there. I mean, we don't have a contraction plan.
No.
So,
where there's smoke, there's fire, usually, and this much talking about it, you got to figure it's coming. So
yeah, I think so. So, you know, I think that's going to change the strategy of a lot of GMs, and we can see it's probably changing tree living strategy on this one.
I could even see a lot of strange 2-year contracts given out on UFA Day, especially for teams that have a lot of cap available, just to, cause you have to expose 25% of your cap for the expansion draft. If it is actually a go, then I think, you'll see some overly inflated 2-year deals for like $3 or $4 million just for marginal players.
Yeah,
so that way they can expose that guy.
Or somebody overpaying your sort of AHL veteran guy, your Aaron Johnson type guy.
Yeah, same kind of situation.
So, yeah, no,
that's why I don't think Matt Stajan will be going anywhere after this season.
I think you could be right about that, but they need to announce the expansion draft first, because wouldn't you look like an idiot if you started doing that?
Well, usually they do it at the draft prior to it actually happening. That's the way they did it before with Nashville and all that.
Well, I think the league has said that by the time the team, whoever it is, hits the stage to make the first overall pick, we'll know if there's expansion next year or not.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're going to tell us about 2018, but I know at least for this year, I'm pretty sure that we're going to see a Vegas expansion. And we talked about that last year. I think if there is expansion, it's Las Vegas.
At least the first one.
Yeah.
The second one, it could be any of half a dozen places.
I think it'll be interesting to see how this affects teams going forward, too. A guy like, you know, Bolig, who might not get another deal, I could see them potentially inflating in a deal just to eat up some cap and make him eligible. He's got 2 years left with the Flames right now. But, yeah, I could see them making him – somebody sign a player like that and, just giving them an inflated deal.
Yeah, just like sort of like what the Florida Panthers did the year that they made the playoffs last time, where they signed like a whole bunch of quality third and fourth line guys for like $3 million each just to get to the cap floor. And, you know, they were just okay players, like guys like Sean Bergenheim, that okay but not
great players.
Sort of
like when the Flames signed Derek England to an almost $3 million contract to get to the cap floor?
Well, kind of, sort of, yeah.
I mean, and, you know, we signed Raymond to a $2.2 million. I think that was a cap floor move, too.
Yeah, same here. And just that kind of type of player getting those types of contracts where it's slightly more than they should, but enough where you can expose that, because you only are going to need about $18 million to expose in the expansion draft. So, you know, guys like Stajan, like that's like $3 million there. You only have X number of other players that you need to do that for, and then you're there. So,
yeah, and I mean, we'll, you might even see a guy like Josh Juris, who's, you know, making $975,000 this year, and you could argue might not be in line to make any more, potentially just get an inflated one-year deal or two-year deal, just to, yeah, bring that number up.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we're signing a bunch of two big contracts, especially this summer, we're 25%. That's not going to be that hard to fill.
No.
I don't know exactly what they're going to be, so I don't want to project what that could be. But, yeah, that's not going to be that hard to fill. I mean, you could have a guy making $2 million pretty much. You know, that's your 25%. I mean, it's not going to be hard to expose 25% without losing a good player on this team.
Yeah. So that's why it'll be an interesting offseason, and hopefully the Flames can figure out a way to... Like, especially one of the problems that the Flames have is that a lot of their higher dollar guys are expiring contracts next season. So they may end up having to, like, buy somebody out or something in order to sign another similar type guy just for on a two-year deal.
Well, and that's where you might even make a deal taking somebody's bad contract back.
Yeah. That could work.
You know, we might trade something, get something back, and say this time, okay, we're okay now. We're ready to take on that bad contract, because
that 2 year bad contract, not the.
Yeah, but I mean, there's some teams I think that might need to get rid of Sun, even if it's that quick. You know, even if it's only expiring in the next 2 years, and I think you might see us make a deadline move or something that might be, yeah, okay, we'll happily take your bad contract.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot of bizarre trades and signings, I feel, in the next 12 months.
And I think that's where you're going to start seeing things that aren't necessarily hockey moves. They're expansion draft prevention moves. I think we're going to be sitting here scratching our heads over the next year, really going, huh, they really made that trade? Not just with the Flames, but with all sorts of teams.
Well, that's why I think the Flames will be able to get a pretty decent goaltender for nothing just because of that.
You could be right. Somebody just scared that they're going to lose their team. Or their goalies, I guess. And, yeah, want to get something for them. You're probably right. I can definitely see that happening. Talking about guys the Flames might acquire, Flames are short on right wingers right now, and it looks like we happen to have two disgruntled Russian right wingers in the league, Nikushkin and Yakupov. What would you think if the Flames were to chase down either one of those guys, Matt?
Why not? You know, if you're getting them for a reasonable rate, like, I wouldn't be going and, like, giving the Flames second round pick or a quality player in the NHL for either player, but it would depend on exactly what they're asking. Like, if you look at what the Oilers got for Justin Schultz, a third round pick and I think a conditional later round pick, if they asked something similar for Yakupov, I would consider it. Why not? Nikushkin would probably be a little bit more like Dallas's second round pick going back or something similar.
As much as I'm not a huge fan of his, and I think maybe it's just because he's been an Oiler, I think that right now as a transitional winger, Yakupov might be the better option just because I think he's going to be cheaper to bring in.
Yeah, same here.
I wouldn't bring him in and sign him long term by any means. But I think that as a guy who might be here for a couple of years, he could be a good transitional player.
Yeah, and if all things are equal, I might even just go and sign Daniel Preble from the Czech League and throw him into the spot that you would throw either of those two players in.
Well, I guess the only thing about these guys is you know what you're getting.
True.
You know, with Preble, as we talked about last week, sometimes this whole European free agent thing works, sometimes it doesn't. We need a lot of wingers. No reason you couldn't bring both in. But if we could get Yakupov, who's making $2.5 million for, you know, a third-round pick, if you looked at we're paying Raymond $2.2 million, Yakupov's an upgrade over him.
Yeah, I kind of argue with that.
So,
and if it largely depends on acquisition costs. Like, if it makes sense, then sure, why not? But if it's expensive, then there are always other options, whether that's going and signing somebody in UFA or whatever.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, I think that Edmonton is going to be in a spot where they're going to be open to offers. And only
there. And it could be a situation like the Canucks were with Hunter Shinkaruk, where they just wanted to get something for him. And, like, I'm sure that they didn't want to send him to Calgary just because of the divisional rivalry and all that, but the Flames offered the best thing for him, and they took it instead of just letting Shinkaruk go, I guess.
So what do you think would be a fair price for Yakupov?
The Flames' third and maybe a depth prospect like Augustino or something, I think that would be the ballpark. Maybe a Josh Juris instead.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think that Edmonton needs guys that are going to be ready fairly quickly. I think they need, you know, young NHL-ready guys. I don't know that Agostino's there, and I don't know they'd want him for that reason.
Yeah, well, similarly, you could see a guy like Wotherspoon or Kulak go.
Well, that's what I was thinking. I was thinking they're going to want to trade for blue liners, not for forwards. I was thinking to myself a third-rounder and either Wotherspoon or Kulak. Because those guys, while they're not going to save the Oilers on the blue line, they're one more piece that's going to help them build a competent back end.
Yeah.
And I think,
and that's what they need, is that internal competition.
Yeah, and I think with both, Wotherspoon especially, but you know what you're getting there. You know, like, you've seen him at the NHL level. It's not a UFA. It's not a, you know, European guy. You know what this kid's done at the NHL level, and he has something under his belt to, you know, to really be able to say, okay, for better or for worse, this is who this guy is. So, yeah, I could definitely see that happening. I would be okay with that. I know a lot of people don't want Yakupov in here. From what I understand, he's not a bad guy to have around on the team. He's not like he's a dressing room cancer or anything, from what I've heard. What about you?
No.
So, I think, you know, he'd be fine to have around. I think, you know, there might be a stigma there about him being an Oiler, sort of like when Schmid came over. A lot of people were saying, oh, you know, we can't have him. And I think there's just this prejudice because he played for the Oilers, which I can't blame us. I mean, that's kind of how we're bred, is those are the enemies. But, yeah, I could definitely see the Flames at least throwing in an offer. I don't want them to go crazy and overpay for this kid. He's not worth it. But if you can do a decent deal, I could see Yakupov in a Flames jersey next year.
It couldn't hurt, you know, to see kick the tires.
Yeah, I mean,
why not?
You don't want to get so involved with this guy that it ends up being a scenario of, you know, oh yeah, we need this kid. You know, we must have him. Like, you know, he's the only right wing solution we've got. That's not true. There's lots of solutions there.
Oh no, like it realistically, if the Flames wanted to, they could just go sign a couple of players like Troy Brouwer and like David Backes, and you're good to go. So if worse comes to worse, like, they could just offer some UFA contracts out and problem solved. So,
and I think that also depends how close you think we are realistically to a playoff. I still think we're a couple years away, and so we're not really looking to build that playoff team. And with that in mind, I think that Yakupov, you know, any of the guys you mentioned, Brouwer, would be a just fine choice for now. You know, Brouwer's not a guy I'd want if I'm going deep in a, you know, second, third right wing role. But I think for right now, based on where I think the team's going to be, why not?
Yeah. Well, I think in Brouwer's case, he's basically the same mold of player, like quality second, third line guy like Frolik, just a more physical guy. So, like, I wouldn't be wanting him to play with Gaudreau or Monahan. Like, that's not the type of guy he is.
No, he's not. And I mean, you know that. He's been around the league long enough. You know what you're getting with Troy Brouwer. He's also 30, and I think he's, because of that, he'd be more of a short-term player than a longer-term guy. But, yeah, you never know. I think, again, he'd be a fine stopover. I think Yakupov would be a fine stopover. I'd be okay paying a third and a defensive prospect for Yakupov, but that's about as much as I would pay.
Yeah. Like, I wouldn't give Florida a second for him.
No. And, I mean, remember that this year Troy Brouwer is sitting at 38 points. So, you know, not a guy who's known for a lot of offense. Last year he had 43 points with Washington. But, you know, 38 points, that'd be a nice addition to our offense.
Yeah, that's basically adding another Frolik in terms of offense. And he brings that physical side, so...
Yeah, I think Frolik has...
And the Flames were after him before. Like, when he got traded from Chicago to Washington, the Flames were the only other team that was close with the trade offer.
Okay, I didn't know that. Do you know what they were offering? Do you remember?
They were offering a second round pick plus something, and Washington upped it to their first, which I do believe they drafted Evgeny Kuznetsov with that pick.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
Or something. I can't remember the exact. Yeah.
But
I'm probably mistaken.
Yeah.
Entirely, but whatever.
I think if Yakupov moves, we're going to see that move made at the draft. I think Nikushkin might be further down. And I was just kind of going through trade discussions we've had here. We talked earlier in the year about Hamonic possibly coming here, and that just kind of died off. I don't really see that happening anymore. What about you?
No. And realistically, with the expansion draft, you can only protect three defensemen.
Watch it. We have our three. I'd hate to pay for Hamonic and lose him.
Yeah, and I think for that very reason, the Flames, if they're going to add a defenseman, it'll likely be a veteran UFA signing. Because, like, if the Flames lose Joki Paakka or new UFA signing holdover guy or something like that, who cares? You know, if that's all you're losing, that's not a big deal.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd be kind of choked if we lost Joki Paakka.
Oh, same here. Like, I don't want him to go, but if that's how it broke down, you're like, well, if that's the only thing that you're losing, then that's not a big deal in the scheme of things.
Yeah, I think you might be able to bring in a defenseman. You know, I'm looking at defensemen who are expected to be UFAs this year. A guy like Eric Brewer, Jordan Leopold, Scott Hannon. You might be able to bring a guy in if they're going to bring somebody in who might be enticing enough as sort of a veteran leader for an expansion team that they leave Joki Paakka alone.
Yeah. By the way, that Brouwer trade, it was the pick that became Philip Danio to Chicago.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah, I was mistaken.
You know, just looking at the list of UFA defensemen, if they do go that way, which I don't think we have room to bring another veteran, but I could see Volchenkov at $1 million this year being a decent candidate there.
Yeah, there's always somebody available in that veteran 4-5 type role.
Yeah,
if the Flames are skating into next season with England as the number 4, we're pretty much going to be right where we are. Like, I could even see a guy like Brian Campbell, who's 37, being that kind of a fit.
Yeah. Yeah, and again, I think based on where our team is going to finish next year, in my estimation, that works.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. Like, you're not going to get a sexy name to join the team. Like, it's going to be
and with that a more meat and potatoes type guy. You're not going to pay for another Hamilton just to lose him.
Exactly.
Because I think there's no question the three guys we protect are Geo, Brody, Hamilton on the back end.
Yeah, for sure. No doubt about it.
You know, if we lose Yogi Paco, well, it's the cost of doing business, I guess.
Yeah. Like, if you're, at the end of the day, if that's the only guy that you lose, you're laughing. Because, really, it sucks, but even a guy like him is replaceable.
And, I mean, we talked last week, I think there's a lot of good potential targets on this team. You know, I could see an expansion team potentially want to take a guy like Stajan. I think they might take a guy like
Lance Bolma.
I could even see potentially someone like Josh Juris if he has a good year next year. Ferland, some people suggested. Like, I think there's a lot of guys in this team, as much as we like them because they're Flames, in the grand scheme of things, if they leave, they're easily replaceable.
Yeah. And, like, if you're looking at longer-term contracts, like, for two seasons from now, like the 17-18 season, the Flames, at this point, the only two players that they have that are under contract at this point that you would expose are Bolma and Stajan, and between them, they're making, like, 5.3. So the Flames will have to find another $13 million on top of those two.
Yeah, well, you're going to have the big deals with Goudreau and Monahan.
Well, you're not going to expose them.
No, that's true. But as far as your 25%, though, I think that's going to bring up what that 25% is going to be. So, yeah, you just need
I think it's 25% of, like, the total cap. So I think it's, like, the $70 million or whatever.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't sure if it was the total cap or the guys who played on your NHL roster.
Yeah, I'm not sure either, but I would assume that they'd make it across the board the same number, but they might not, so who knows.
Yeah, well, I think, yeah, it might not be because you don't want teams burying guys in the minors, but at the same time, if they do, they've got to clear waivers, so who knows. We will find out as we go forward, I guess.
Yeah, well, when they announce what the procedures are, then we'll get clarity on that.
Talking about guys who might come or go, we've talked about the goaltending scenario this year. Yoni Ordio announced to The Sun in an interview this week that he is and his agent have had some initial discussions with the Flames, but haven't had any real, you know, tangible numbers talk, and we're not close to a deal yet. You and I have debated Ordio all year, and we'll talk more next week in our season recap about him, but how would you feel if the Flames signed Ordio again?
If we were back in, say, January, I would have said, we could find somebody better. But then Ordio got a chance in the NHL, and he has played well. And he's not great. Like, even though he's been playing good for him, he's still not a good goaltender, in my opinion. That said, if he can take those steps, he is only 24, 25. If he can take those next steps next year, like, I would have him as the backup. I don't see, like, for a backup, he's a good goaltender, but for a starter, like, you're pretty much...
Well, I don't think there's any way that the Flames could come into next season and say Ordio's our starter.
Yeah. Like, if you're saying that he's the starter, then you might as well just pencil in the 27 top five pick.
I think if the team comes in with him as the starter, True Living and Burke are both packing their bags and heading out of town. I mean, they've identified that they need a goaltender. You can't say, well, we've done an exhaustive search, and the best goaltender we can find... Especially
is the mediocre backup.
Especially
guy
in a year
had.
When there's going to be some goaltender movement, both because of free agency and the expansion draft, you can't say the best guy you can possibly find when we have some trade chips to play with is Yoni Ordio.
Yeah. And like, you got to figure that teams like, say, Pittsburgh and Tampa, they're both having a couple of good quality goaltenders in their organization between Tristan Jarry and Matt Murray in Pittsburgh and Andrei Vasilevsky and Christer Gudelevskys in Tampa. So Ben Bishop and Marc-Andre Fleury quickly become expendable, and if the Flames wanted to acquire either, I don't think that the cost would be very much, especially because each of those teams would be saving cap hits so they could reinvest elsewhere.
I think the biggest thing with those guys is going to be the looming expansion draft. Otherwise, you're not going to be looking at moving one of your goaltenders if you're Pittsburgh.
No, exactly. But Murray's come in and played well since Fleury went down with a concussion, so... And, like, I could even see Arizona trying to give Mike Smith to us to, like, here, take him, please. Because Domingue has played really well.
Yeah, Domingue's been a big surprise this year.
Yeah, so...
So I think there's goalies out there. I don't necessarily think that Ordeo needs to be banished from the organization. I don't think he needs to be signed and sent to Europe or any of that. I think that there's still hope for Ordeo. Maybe yeah. I'm being too optimistic. I don't think he's anywhere near a starter, nor do I think he'll ever be a starter. But he could be that capable backup that plays years in the league as a backup. And the one thing the Flames have lacked for years is a good backup. I mean, a quality, long-term backup goaltender. And I think that could be Ordeo. His biggest Achilles heel, in my mind, is how long it takes this kid to get started. We've talked about how long it takes him to be ready. This year, it took him most of the season. I mean, he didn't look good until he got recalled in, what, February?
Yeah, something like that. Like, he was pretty much a disaster in Stockton all year.
I mean, he was kind of penciled in to be the backup starting the year here and lost the job in Stockton to Poulin, and finally came back and earned it. And I think with the way he's played, he deserves another contract, whether it's an NHL or a European or an AHL deal. I think he deserves another deal. But there's no way you can put this guy in as a starter. And I'm honestly worried about the first couple games he backs up, if he's going to be ready or not. But I think it's a risk that next year is okay taking.
Yeah. Well, I think with him, like, if you're... He seems to be, at times, a little mentally fragile, which isn't... Each of the last handful of years, like, if you look back when he came back over from Finland, the Flames had Joey McDonald, Rado Barra, and Kari Ramo in the organization, and he was an absolute disaster to start the year, and that's the year he started in the ECHL, and was bad for the first little while before working his way back up into the NHL at the end of that season. Then this year, he was on a one-way deal, so he should have been in the NHL, but you had Ramo, Hiller, and Ordeo, and he seemed to, like, the competition there for a spot, it seemed to interfere with his play. And, like, last year, he was slightly better throughout the season, but, like, you knew that he wasn't going to get a spot. This year, he should have had a spot. And I think if the Flames just say, you're going to be the backup, I think that he might get out of his own way mentally and be able to prepare, like, I am going to be one of the guys in the NHL. Who knows?
Yeah, no, I think you're right there. And I think that's one of the things that a lot of people haven't thought of, is this guy was sort of seen for a while as the heir apparent to Kiprusoff. Kipper's gone. Ordeo's the next heir apparent. And I think you're right. I think they were putting too much pressure on him. And I think if we can define for him what that role is, look, we've got Ranta or Ward or Bishop or whoever it is, who is the number one guy. We're not asking you to take this guy's job. We're not asking you to come out and outplay this guy. We're just asking you to sit on the bench, open the door, and when we need you, go put on a solid game of hockey every 10 games.
Or even every 6 games or 5 games.
Yeah, like whatever it might be.
You know, because I'm assuming that he's going to end up playing about 25 to 30 games next year, give or take.
Yeah, I think that depends on, again, how well he comes out. If he stinks the place up in his first couple, I think they'd reduce that load.
True.
And based on what we've seen, I have no reason to think that he wouldn't. I mean, I hate to say it, but he's not a good starter. He doesn't start the game well. So, yeah, no, I think you're right. And I think that if we kind of tell him this is your role, take it or leave it. We're signing you as this role. Yes, maybe you overtake the goalie, and that's great if you do, the starting goalie, but you're being signed as a backup. Our expectation is you're going to sit on the bench most of the year.
Yeah, and if you define his role and, like, whether you play like crap or you're awesome, this is where you're going to be. And if you play awesome, maybe you start stealing some starts from the other guy. And maybe you even overtake him. But either way, you're going to be the backup. I think that would help him mentally prepare for the season instead of being in flux like he was.
Our expectation for you is the backup. It's not, you know, you're sort of in the mix, win a job. It's our expectation is as backup.
Yeah, and like if the Flames do acquire a Fleury or a Bishop or Mike Smith or Jimmy Howard or whatever, a guy that can play 60-plus games, if Ordeo does play terribly consistently next year, then acquiring a backup to replace Ordeo down the stretch, that wouldn't be an expensive ad.
No, and I think even within our system, we'll see Poulin come back, and that might be your other backup option.
Yeah, or Gillies, depending on how he plays.
Yeah, I don't know. Because
you might, like, it wouldn't be all season. It would be, like, from February on.
Yeah, I think that's also going to depend how Stockton's doing. I mean, they may want to keep quality goaltending in Stockton.
True.
And if they do what we expect them to do, what we expect them to do this year, I think that they'd want to keep Gillies down there just to get minutes.
I agree.
But yeah, it's interesting. But to me, I mean, I've always liked Ordeo. I've been kind of disappointed with him the last couple of years. I never saw him necessarily as the heir apparent to Kiprusoff. I didn't see this guy as the next goaltender to lead us to a cup, but I thought he's a good guy to have around the organization. He's solid. He's...
Yeah, basically like a young Kari Ramo. A solid 1B goalie.
Yeah. And, I mean, if the Flames sign him and they decide as a group between Ordeo and his people and the Flames people that, you know what, we want to try Europe for a year, I'd be okay with that, too. I mean, it worked well for Ramo.
Yeah. I think if that happens, I don't think Ordeo comes back to the Flames, but...
I don't know. I think it depends how that decision's arrived at. If it's just kind of a numbers game of, you know what, we want to keep him here. We want to see what happens. We're going to bring in a different backup. I could see them bringing him back after that. If he's on like a 2 or 3 year deal, bring him back after a year and say, okay, you know, it was a loan to Europe and you're a lot better now. Look at what it did for Giordano.
Yeah. I don't know how that would work personally, but
it wouldn't be my preference, but I think that, you know, I don't want to just let this guy walk. They've played him in enough games to retain him as an RFA, and if that's the only spot you've got for him, send him over there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it'll be interesting to see what happens with Ordeo going forward and what happens in net in general. But moving out from the net, Matt, we've seen some call-ups this season. We've seen some emergency call-ups and some regular call-ups. And really, there's only one of the emergency guys left on the team right now, and that's Hunter Shinkaruk. To me, he's been the best call-up down the stretch. What about you?
He's been okay. I honestly don't see any of the guys that the Flames have called up being a full-time NHL player next year. Shinkaruk, he did score a goal and got an assist, but I think that he still needs a lot to go to learn a 200-foot game. He's okay. I wouldn't say any of the players really overly stood out.
See, the thing with Shinkaruk to me is he still looks the same as he did in the Vancouver system when I saw him. And I don't know if he necessarily needs to learn a 200-foot game. I think he just might need to learn how to play a Calgary Flames style of hockey and the Stockton Heat style of hockey and where he fits in there. I can see Shinkaruk getting a look, a good hard look this summer as an NHL player. I think if Josh Juris can make the roster, Hunter Shinkaruk can make the roster.
Yeah, honestly, I think that you would more likely see a guy like Emil Poirier make the team out of camp next year than Shinkaruk.
I'd hope so. I mean, you know, I'm hoping for Poirier, but based on what we saw in the call-up and based on what we've seen in the A this year, He's had a tough year, and I think...
Yeah, actually, I thought he was surprisingly good in his call-up, oddly enough. A more of a defensively sound player, and yeah, he didn't do much offensively, but if you're looking for a third, fourth line guy, I think Poirier would have the leg up in that regard.
For sure, and I wouldn't look at bringing a Hunter Shinkaruk up to be a defensively minded guy. I don't think that's his role or his position that he'd be good at all. I think that if you want that defensive minded guy, yeah, Poirier is probably the right guy. If any of them are going to make the team, it's probably Grant.
Actually, in my opinion, I think that if anybody's going to make it, it'll be Jankowski.
Really? Well, he's not one of the call-ups, so...
True, but the youngish group of players.
Yeah, no, I would go... Okay, if we throw Jankowski in, we could look at any of the guys that are down in Stockton, then yeah, I think there's guys that'll probably make it, I think, more on the back end. But if we're looking at the guys that have been called up... To me, I think Poirier might make it as a third-line guy. I think Grant's probably a shoe-in if he sticks around. I can see him taking Bolig's job almost and Bolig being relegated to the A next year or bought out. But, yeah, I don't know. I like Shinkaruk. I like what he brings. I think he still has a lot to learn about his game and who he is. I mean, he only played one game with Vancouver. At the NHL level, so I think there's still a diamond in the rough, but I'm liking what I'm seeing of it so far.
Yeah, if he doesn't progress from this point on, I don't think he'll be an NHL player, but the Flames still have him for 2 years before he's waiver eligible, so plenty of time for him to adapt and grow as a player.
I guess we look at it as a whole. I have more faith in Shinkaruk growing to what he needs to be than I did in Granlund growing to what he needed to be.
Same here. Well, Granlund is an okay third, fourth line guy.
But I think Granlund's hit his peak.
Yeah, so do I. I think that's what he is. And that's more of like a 15, 20, maybe 25 point player on your third and fourth line, nothing exceptional. And especially with the Flames having such a large amount of center depth, you know, like there's just no room for that.
So I think even if we look at it that way, that Shinkaruk has a much more interesting future ahead of him potentially than Granlund did, I think that we can say that even looking at it that way, we won this deal. I think you're right about Granlund. He is what he is now. He's that third-line center, maybe a second-line center on a weak team. But, I mean, he's not going to be a top-six guy. I think Shinkaruk...
No, I think...
I think Shinkaruk has the potential to be, but he's not going to be there for a few years.
Yeah, pretty much.
I like what we've seen so far, and I think that Shinkaruk is looking good, and he will, it's been announced, play his first home game in Calgary as a Calgary boy, so his home debut... on Tuesday against the LA Kings. So, you know...
Yeah, I wonder how many tickets that he's going to be buying over the next couple of days. I'd probably guess in the 300 to 400 range.
Well, I imagine there's probably about 300 or 400 tickets left. It's the last two home games of the year. And I don't think that he you know, is probably going to have a lot of competition for those tickets. But we should hook him up on Twitter with our friends at TickTix. Because they could probably get him some tickets. Before we get into our finale of the show, as we do every year, our weekly recap and preview for the last time this season, I wanted to let everybody know that as it is the end of the year, Fanatic, both online and in-store, having a 40% off sale. All Flame stuff is 40% off. So if you see anything that you like, go and do the Fanatic sale. Do it online. Do it in the store. Pick something up. Jerseys I was looking at are like $83. Not too bad at all if you want a jersey, even though this will be the last year of the current jersey. Crested jerseys aren't much more. There's a lot of really cool stuff. There's stuff for like $5-6. There's stickers for $1. So 40% off. You can't go wrong with Flame stuff. So Matt, with that, why don't we look at the week ahead in our recaps from last week. Last week we had our six games. You and I both made our predictions. I finally got 2 points. I got what I needed to tie you. I came into the week down by two. I predicted we'd get 2 points on the week by beating Edmonton. You thought we'd sweep with six, so now we are tied 6-6.
Which, after a full season, that is quite pathetic.
Well, if you look at the number of times we've all been right, I mean, that means you've been right about three times. You got 2 points early. You got 2 points in the
The first week of the season.
First week of the season, you held those 2 points all the way through to December 23rd. You got another extra point on the 4th of January and held that till January 25th, where you did well. And then got your last point of the season on March 8th. So you've kind of been holding the lead all year. And I've really just been catching up this last little bit here in the season. So just like the Flames, we're down to overtime. And it's, I guess, 3-on-3 overtime because we got 3 games left.
Yep.
So before we get into it, let's remind everybody again, we got 2 more home games this week. We've got the Kings and the Vancouver Canucks. So if you want to come to one of those home games, get your tickets. They'll be fun games. It's always fun at the Dome, but this is your last chance. Don't have regret that you didn't come to the game. And you can make sure you're there by using TickTix. TickTix connects the Sea of Red to buy and sell tickets securely from their smartphones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so buyers don't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick them up. You just print them out or take your phone. They'll scan them at the Dome. It's easy. Download TickTix today for free in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. It's available free in either one of those. So download TickTix and let's see everybody who listens to the show out at the Dome for the final 2 games of the year here at home.
Just asking, with the last predictions, do you want to also throw in scores for the games? So if we get those right, like as a bonus add-on point?
As a tiebreaker?
Yeah.
Sure, if you want to do that, we can do that, make things interesting.
Yeah, because it's only 3 games, so, you know.
I thought maybe I'd just meet you in my living room with some, you know, mini hockey sticks and we'd have a shootout, but that works too.
Okay.
Matt, do you want to make your predictions first?
Yeah, sure. And I'll go with 2 points beating Vancouver. And the LA game, I'll say, is a 4-1 loss. The Canucks game, a 3-2 win, and the Wild game, a 5-2 loss.
Wow. You're not much faith in this team this week.
No.
All right, well, I'm going to go... I've been debating back and forth on this, exactly what I want to do. I'm going to say that we're going to have 3 points. I think, as you do, that we're going to beat Vancouver. That team's kind of coming apart since the trade deadline, and I think we might be able to beat them. I'm going to go with... I'm debating on the Kings game. I don't know if we're going to get slaughtered or not. I'm going to go 3-1, the Kings game, loss. I'm going to say for the Vancouver game, a 4-2 win. And for Minnesota, I'm going to say that the Flames win 3-2 in overtime.
Well, wouldn't that be 4 points?
Oh, sorry, you're right. So the
lose.
It would be lose 3-2.
Okay.
I was just looking at the games here and forgot what I'd predicted. My bad.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, I think that we'll beat Vancouver 4-2. I don't know about the Minnesota game. You know what? I'm gonna change it. I'm gonna go Minnesota, we're gonna win in overtime. So I'm gonna go 4 points. Just looking at the schedule here, yeah, I think that we might be able to beat them. So I'll say that we'll beat them, and whether it's overtime or not, we're going to go 4 points. So that's my prediction. Vancouver, Minnesota, we get the win, and I think the Minnesota game will be a 3-2 win. It's going to be pretty damn close.
Well, that works.
But
that way, I figure with the tiebreakers, if any of us, either of us, get any of the 6 games correct score-wise, that'll help.
We're all different, so if we, I mean, hopefully we're not going to have to go that way, but if we do, great.
Yeah, at least, you know, like, it, say, like, it ends up being, like, a 3-point week, and we both get the Vancouver game right.
Knowing maybe how this score season's gone so far, it's probably going to be exactly that. It's going to be a 3-point week or a 0-point week.
Yeah.
It's going to be whatever we didn't predict.
Yeah. or a 4-point week, but or some permutation where we both screw up, or a 5-point week or whatever.
You know, it's interesting looking back at our predictions here. You were the least optimistic this year. 1, 2, 3, 4 times you predicted the Flames to get skunked.
Yeah, well...
8, 9 times you predicted that the Flames would get 2 points on a week. I tended to be a little bit more optimistic, more usually, not always, but I think that was my downfall, as I was too optimistic most weeks.
Yeah. Well, the team's been kind of bad this year, so being more on the pessimistic side has helped.
Yeah, and we've sort of picked it up recently. You know, we've been playing better, but then this past week they sort of tanked any momentum that they had coming in. Not just with losses, but with just terrible games.
Yeah. Well, at least with the final week and a bit on the standings, the Flames are not going to be able to move higher likely than finishing in the bottom six. And they'll likely finish either 4th, 5th, or 6th. So, you know, there, at that point, there's not really any difference in terms of the draft lottery. It's a crapshoot between all those teams. The good thing is that we're not likely going to move down in the draft if we're finishing 6th. So,
you think Ordeo plays the 2 home games?
Probably.
Matt, do you think that Ordeo will play the 2 games here at the Dome?
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. I think that the Flames want to have the best team in front of the home fans.
After the performances we've seen from Nicholas Backstrom recently, do you still think that they're probably going to give him the start in Minnesota?
I would feel fairly confident that he will start that one. Even though, like, it's a game, like, any time the 82nd game of the season happens and neither side has anything to play for, I think that you're just giving whomever a shot, and I think that Backstrom makes sense there. Because, like, even if the Flames lose 10-1, who gives a crap at that point?
I have a feeling that may be Backstrom's final NHL game.
Same here.
And I think it would be fitting to let him go out in Minnesota.
Same here.
So I think, if nothing else, it's a nice gesture, especially if he's already made, and I don't know if he has or not, don't, you know, think I have some insider information, but if he's already made some notions that maybe he's hanging them up next year, that might be a nice game to give him. And it's not really going to matter either way. I mean, that's inconsequential.
Yeah, and realistically, the Flames will probably have their final standings sorted out by then anyway, so... It wouldn't make any difference, or would make very little difference.
And I mean, neither of us think that the Flames are going to be that successful, even though I'm predicting that they win that one. I think it's going to be an ugly game either way, so it probably doesn't matter who you're putting in there.
Yeah, because I'm sure that Minnesota will be starting a bunch of prospects instead of their normal guys just to rest up for game one, likely against Dallas.
Yeah, or flipping the minutes. You know, give the fourth line first line minutes, third line second line minutes.
Yeah, so on and so forth.
Well, Matt, enjoy the last 3 games. Savor them while you can, because we're going to be without Flames hockey until September.
Yep, and we'll be back for the draft stuff and all that.
Well, even before that, we'll be back next week to do our season wrap-up to talk about the last 3 games. But, I mean, that's the end of Flames hockey. Yeah, there's other things to talk about. But this team's not going to the postseason. They're going to be starting to book their tee times.
Yep. So, not the season that anybody would have wanted, but that's life.
But the season we deserve based on the way we approached it.
Oh, yeah.
Based on the way the Flames played and the way this team, you know, was put together, this is the season we deserved.
Yep. Too much on the top end, not enough in the middle, and nothing at the bottom, so...
And terrible in between the net.
Yeah, well... I don't think anybody could have foreseen all three of the goaltenders playing as badly.
No, we'll see what happens next week.
Yeah.
All right, Matt. Well, you enjoy your week, and I will talk to you as we wrap up the season next week.
Thanks for listening, everybody, and one more to go, and then we'll be getting ready for the draft and all that stuff. So thanks for listening, and take care.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.